And children went this way. Come on.
Oh, Hiram. Could the moon stay shielded by this cloud so we could find a refuge?
Heaven has stayed the purpose of our foes before. Surely now we can find some protection. Brother Gooding's house lies just beyond the corner. Go first. Let me shield you from behind.
Why are you always there to shield me?
I have no time to answer now. Precede me. It will give my spirit light even to follow you.
Could you still perhaps outrun me? I may have been the stronger, but you are more light, more quick. Let's try.
Hey!
Brother Gooding, could you bet us down?
Of course, yes. I heard the bottom of the street. Come in. I can make a pallet for you in the back room.
Thank you, Brother Gooding.
Good night.
Good night, Hiram.
Good night.
I feel that sleep, though wound, will not be won. The rattled sleeve of care is still our lot. Hiram, do you recall us wrestling in our yard in Lebanon?
I sure do. But I remember, too, the day you first came down with that last illness. It was then, I think, that I realized you were destined for some unusual purpose of the Lord. Do you remember?
My first recollections are of the closeness between Hiram and myself. Throughout our lives, we were very close. And as children, Hiram being the eldest, would take it upon himself to look out for me and was always my closest friend. He included me in his games, such as running races in the field, which would often end in a wrestling match.
While swinging, I bet if I tried hard enough, I could just soar right into the top of the sky over there.
Well, don't, but I could.
I think you could if you put your mind to it. I suppose you could do anything.
Even get you down?
Maybe.
Dare me.
Dare me. What is it? Did I hurt you?
lie down. Don't look so scared. I'll soon be getting you down again.
I hope so. But I don't like to fight you, even in fun. You're my best friend.
And you're mine. Is that why you let me win?
I don't. I fight hard.
Maybe I'm as gifted as much as you say then.
It's true. Sometimes I'm almost jealous of you.
Almost? Oh, Hiram, you'll stay with me, won't you? We won't worry, Mother.
Of course. Take it easy now. Oh, Joseph, you're burning with fever. Let's get back to the house.
I was ill with a fever only 2 weeks, but it left me with complications. The doctor said the pain in my shoulder was a sprain, but it later proved to be an abscess, which eventually healed, but the infection settled in my left leg. Then my leg began to swell. After watching me suffer for several weeks, my father called in another doctor, who eventually performed 2 surgeries on my leg. When the leg did not mend properly, he called in a 3rd physician, who at first was in favor of amputation.
We opened the leg twice before. The first time we went very deep. The last time we almost touched the bone. We've decided now that the only thing we can do is amputate.
It's quite necessary. We shall need to take him to the hospital for that, though. He must be prepared.
But the nearest hospital is over 50 miles away.
We know. We'll arrange to have him transported there.
But, Doctor, can't you give it one more try? Can't you cut closer to the bone? Perhaps it will again heal over. He cannot take his leg without one more try. I cannot let you.
My mother, we must leave it in their hands and in the hands of the Lord.
I know it is the will of the Lord that his leg be saved.
I'm in favor of amputation.
You do not know these people's faith. You do not know the power of intuition, call it what you will, that this lady has. If she says it is not the Lord's will, I don't know. Being that he is my patient, we've decided to try it one more time. We'll do it here, with your good help. Perhaps if we scrape the bone, nature will heal.
I have the water on the stove and the sheets prepared.
You must have been quite sure of our decision.
Through the years, you've been a kindly man to a doctor. I knew you would not let us down now.
Please, God, that we will not have to. Joseph.
You've come again.
Yes, we have come again.
You've not come to remove my leg, have you?
No. We've decided to give it one more try. It is the wish of your parents here and your good brother.
The boy needs to be.
Yes, Hiram. I would rather stay. Perhaps I can help. I promise.
Perhaps you can help your father obtain some cord for binding him.
No, do not do that.
He must be confined while we work.
No.
Some brandy, then. You will take some brandy.
No.
Some wine. Boy, you must take something or you cannot bear the pain.
Let my father sit on the bed and hold me. I can do what I must.
He can, Doctor. He can.
It will be severe. You may even lose consciousness.
All right, then. But, Mother, you should leave me. You've had so much, and you're so worn out.
Oh, no. Let me stay this one little time.
Come with me. I'll take care of you. Be brave, Joseph.
Yes, the Lord is truly with me.
Oh, my son. We will be praying for you. Father, let us pray now.
If you'll excuse us, we'll be washing up.
Oh, I will show you.
We know the way. We've been here 3 times before. I hope this is the last. You certainly must have been sure to have had the water ready.
He's a very special boy, Doctor. His legs must carry him many, many miles. If only he could sleep through it all.
You must be very brave to hold him and very strong. Had he known your tender heart as I do, he might not have asked this of you.
I'm glad he did. Come, let's pray now.
Even with the loving care of my brother Hiram, it took me 3 years to get off my cut crutches. I remember how hard it was on an active little boy to be so confined. Hiram was my sympathetic companion and encouraged me to have patience through my recovery.
I think we will be safe.
Hush.
Here they are. 2 young men asleep, real tired-like.
Maybe they're just pretending. Let's wake them up. That's the way to find out. Question them. Why, old Joe will say he had a vision if we ask him. And then we have him dead to rights. And his brother's just as guilty as he is. Always following him. Believing in him. Let's get them both.
I told you, it's my brother's boys. Stopped here on their way west. They're very tired.
Where is their horse? Or did they walk?
I took it to the livery stable. You can check there tomorrow.
Tomorrow is too late.
We want them tonight. And we're ready for them.
Wait. This one hardly stirs in his sleep. A guilty man sleep like this? Those demons wouldn't sleep like this. They'd be up with us, wrestling with us, and giving us a slip again. But these two, they'd almost be my uncle's boys. Not some madman possessed of superhuman strength claiming to talk with angels. Let's leave them be.
They do look kind of young. And not all that devilish looking. Those dark fiends have given us the slip again!
But not for long, I tell you.
Not for long!
It's kind of you, sir. My brother, who was a wealthy merchant, would not have appreciated my inhospitality had a landing happened to him. Can I see you out? Heaven forgive my lies, but it was the only way.
Heaven be thanked for your ingenuity. And it will not be forgotten. I'm surprised they couldn't hear my heart beating. It almost deafened me. My own heart, too. But calm yourself. I say the hour has not yet come for their villainy. Faith dispels fear. We must rest here a little, and then be on our way while it is still dark. The Son of Darkness moves most treacherously to destroy the things of God which I have found. Let us rest here together, and leave the morning to his invisible hands. Good night, Brother Gooding, and thank you again.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Would I could run part of your course for you.
Beginning of serious persecution. Up to this time, I had been a victim of rebuke. But from that day forward, we all had very little peace. We hoped that the persecutions would cease after moving to the unwanted swamp called Snaboo.
God rest you merry, gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember
oh,
Christ our
dear,
Savior.
Let me not your tie.
Indeed, Mrs. Smith, was for that reason that I came charging into this room.
A man who can speak with angels and decipher hieroglyphics and cannot tie his own tie.
Think how you, gracious lady, would miss the opportunity were I to acquire the tedious ability.
Oh, tedious indeed. You are a handsome man. There is a rumor that certain women are growing fond of you.
There's a rumor attached to every move I make. Believe in me, Emma.
I do. My life shall end if you leave me.
Do not attach your faith to any human being. Attach it to truth. All men are heirs to weakness.
Hiram and Mary will be here soon. Surely he has attached himself to you.
Yes, but to truth as well.
Perhaps I should be jealous of him.
Anyone might be jealous of his loyalty, his goodness. But you must not be jealous of anyone, Emma. It is an ugly emotion. You must just believe and be happy. God himself has said to Lehi that man is that he might have joy.
And are you happy?
Why not? Look at this mansion house. So beautiful, so fine. Look at the city of Nauvoo. The most beautiful city in Illinois. And you, my wife, and my children.
I have so much. I must get my coat. Save the first dance for me, whatever it is.
Oh, you dear man. So human. Yet so filled with divine dreams and power. Oh, this is all so wonderful. My first real home. Afraid it cannot last.
Merry Christmas.
Oh, Sister Mary, come
you?
In. Oh,
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
The mansion home is wonderful.
Thank you.
Merry Christmas, Emma.
Sister Eliza, how are you?
Fine, thank you.
Brother Jones, come in and sit down.
Sister Emma, Sister Eliza Snow has written a beautiful new hymn. Let's have her sing it.
Oh, but not until Joseph comes.
Well, Joseph is here. What is it you would do?
Joseph, have Sister Eliza sing her new song, Oh My Father.
No, no, it is a serious song, much too sober for such a festive occasion.
Since when did poets need to be festive? Sing it for us, please.
No, some other time. It is a sacred song.
We surely must not be sacrilegious, even in our joy. But it is up to you.
Well, then, I did not mean to be disagreeable. I will sing the first verse. Oh, my Father, thou that dwellest.
Sister Eliza, that was beautiful.
Thank you.
Now, where's the dance music? I'm anxious to swing my partner.
We will be dancing in the other room. Brother Jones, will you please lead the way? And Mrs. Smith, will you please be my partner?
Joseph, we'll be along in a minute.
House. Emma, already our own people murmur with envy. I am still a man.
And such a dear man. Because I love you so, there is something I must tell you.
Not bad news, I hope. Not tonight.
It would be difficult tomorrow. I so seldom see you alone lately. You're constantly busy.
Something about the family? One of the children?
No. It's about you. I heard today the hatred and hostility that rising against you in the city. They feel you are overstepping your rights, imposing your own importance and taking part in politics. People are frightened by the militia.
Do you think I'm wrong?
No, but it would seem that religious problems would be enough.
Would you compromise with the evil on all sides of us? Submit as we have submitted without any defense?
No, but there must be some middle ground.
As long as a man can be locked in a prison called Liberty Jail, I'll fight for freedom.
But surely we have been persecuted enough. I thought here, where we have been given a charter, we could live in peace. Have a home.
Emma. Emma, you're not beginning to doubt me too, are you? You're not beginning to crave the comforts of security rather than the ways of the Lord. You knew it would not be easy. When your father turned against me, you remained true. When others failed, you were steadfast. But even those who have been the closest to me have failed me. I would have staked my life on Oliver Cowdery and Sidney Rigdon. Now I long to save them.
What will happen to them now?
I don't know as to this life. I only know that all the gifts and powers that would have been Oliver's in life to come have been lost to him. I have conferred them upon my brother Hiram, who has been loyal from the beginning.
Why then wasn't he chosen to be one of the first three witnesses?
It was not my will. And even if it had been, there would have been more doubt among the inquirers. They would have said, could we take his word for it? He is his brother, naturally.
Will Oliver reverse his testimony that he had seen the place? With him? He was even with you.
No. He is a man of honor. He cannot refute what he has seen and touched and heard. But both he and Sidney are human. And they cannot help it if their humanness turns them against seeming errors. But I swear to you that neither they nor the 11 will go to their graves denying the truth of this work or the book. To deny the power of God and his existence would mean damnation forever.
I'm not really strong, Joseph. You are my strength and my hope. I fear constantly that something will happen to you or the children.
You do not fear too much for yourself, or you would not have sat alone in the buggy while I climbed the hill to get the plates.
I was afraid. I'm still afraid. The memory of crossing that frozen river, carrying my two babies, still haunts me. I ask myself over and over how much more.
Poor Emma. Poor anyone whose life has been attached to mine. Forget our words.
I will. And will you, for my sake, and for the sake of the children, try to be a bit more discreet?
Yes. Perhaps there's some truth in what you say. Because we dared repeat that Jackson County was to be ours, the monsters felt we were to disinherit them all. Perhaps I can yet ease them. Their time is not yet.
Oh, Joseph, you make me very happy.
Do not be alarmed! Our soldiers are thick about the place. Do you hear that noise and that scuffling? We are protected. They will not harm us this time. Do you hear? Who's there?
Sam Jones, sir.
Come in, my boy. Have they gone? Would you get that, please?
Yes, sir. It appears there was just three guards who got intoxicated, thought they might do something on their own. They better arrest them.
I must see to my wife. She ran off.
Emma? Emma, where are you?
Damn, she's run into the night and she took the baby with her.
Merciful heavens, she was so frightened, may I find her
in your coat. You might get ill and then who would lead us? You're a good lad. Now, tell the others to look to my wife. Hurry now.
She could be hiding anywhere. Emma! Emma, come back!
The light grows dim. The wick is burning low. My heart is set with the unrelief of tears. So like a light that has flamed clear and true in white intensity, my life that now seems void, and lonely as the wind that howls the night, wrapping the windows and my very soul with its dark desolation. Oh, my Father, whose very voice has spoken to my soul, whose pristine presence has appeared to me, a boy, not different than other boys have been, yet more intense, perhaps, wanting to know, destined somehow to run this chosen path, difficult, most hazardous to the souls, and blessed, and almost cursed, I think, to know truths that the purest of angels gave to me. Why must I stand here now, alone, entombed within the darkness of my pain, my loss? Have you forsaken me? Removed your arm that has sustained me?
I must not think so blasphemously. Forgive me, Father. And give me strength to bear all things that come. All loss. All grief. There have been many hours, even as now, when to deny the things these mortal eyes have seen and marveled on, would have been easy. Would have been the way to peace of mind, to rest, to a sure cease of the torment of the crown. And the tears of those who saw and mocked me, and the accusations of those who should have been near. But now even the elect have turned aside. Oliver and Sydney, who have seen and been given so much, and have borne solemn witness of the things that they have seen and heard. Why should I be any more select than those who have preceded me? Isaiah and Moses. Moses. Orphan. Prince. Prophet. He gave you Aaron, Moses, even as he has given me Hiram. Faithful. Trusted and wise. Yet it was you who was carried in the cloud. You who saw the finger writing on the stone. I think of you, Moses, out of my own loneliness. An old man who saw the promised land but never entered it. Be so with me. Will I not lead my people on? Must I seal my testimony with tears? Even with my blood? Would that I could deny it all, most sinful creature that I am. Could come this moment to my wife and find in her arms my reassurance and my hope. Oh, heaven. She's unaware of the many things this has written on my soul, as though my lightning has forever. Will she come? Will she leave me too, as others have? Her conscience and her self-pity guiding her. I, at least, must remain true, with God's help.
must run this course until the end. Who is it? Who's there?
Joseph, his mother in Hiram.
Come in. Mother, why have you come?
Greater, more enduring love, the love of God. Many of us have shared his knowledge, have believed, yes, almost known, yet have not seen the radiance of God, nor heard his voice. Oh, I remember well the day Joseph came in from praying in the woods. His young strength spent. Yet in his eyes, there lingered fragments of the celestial things which he had witnessed.
In my 15th year, I had a wonderful experience. Afterward, I called my family together to share it with them.
Mother, Father, I swear to you by everything sacred to us all that it is true. I saw two figures standing in a sky that was suddenly open. It had an endless depth and width. The brilliance of the scene was so intense that my eyes could not behold it, and I fell to the ground. You must believe me, for then they spoke.
Spoke? Who spoke, son? Go on.
Do you believe the lad is ill or mad?
He has never seen more well in his life. His eyes are clear and bright and full indeed of this vision or manifestation he has had.
Oh, you are quite right. I am well. Though indeed it is a wonder that I am. After the terrible struggle I have known.
What struggle, Joseph? Did someone harm you? Did they see it too?
Yes. I am quite sure that they saw it too. They were aware of it. That is why they strove to blur my vision, encompass me with utter darkness. But what strength, what power. My own strength was as a willow in a winter wind. Until...
Who was it, Joseph? Where are they now? What do you mean, until?
Take your time, son. But I am over eager. My flesh is cold.
must be on guard both day and night. It was the power of darkness come to keep my unworthy eyes from beholding the divine vision that was before, above, all around me. Let me begin at the beginning. I had gone into the grove to ask the Lord which one of the many sects preaching and shouting here was true. I had read in the Bible the words, "If ye lacked wisdom, ask in faith, and knowledge would be given you." I gathered my faith as I had never done before. I knelt and prayed aloud with power and fervency out of an overflowing heart.
Aloud, Joseph? I've never heard you pray. Why have I ever questioned your faith?
He said aloud, now let us hear him through.
I did not want to be in disagreement with you who had seen fit to join the Methodists. Yet they did not quite satisfy my soul. And neither did the Presbyterians. Although I was leaning toward their sect, their minister had been so kind.
Go on.
Childlike, I suppose. I took the Lord at his own word and went to him in faith. I asked, which one is true? And now I know.
You know? Were you told? Is that it? Then tell us. We will join. It is as good as done.
None of them are true. Every one of them are false.
Then we are lost. Confusion reigns upon the earth. Surely it has reigned for many days.
No, let him finish. About the attack, Joseph, tell us.
As I prayed aloud, an invisible power, so mighty that my strength was as a child's, fell upon me, wrestled me. And when I had but breath enough to speak, but still prayed on for power to overcome this thing, for knowledge such as I had thirsted for, suddenly I was loosed, and the evil passed. The heavens opened before my eyes, and I beheld two beings. I trembled, and it was as though I was transported from this mortal flesh, wherein I could behold this vision, and partake of the glory that enveloped me. I heard a voice, not like the voice of any I have heard, speaking, filling the earth and the sky with a gentle, pure intensity. The voice said, "Joseph, this is my beloved son. Hear him." I am the one. Mother, you've dreamed dreams and known of things not given ordinary men to know. Father, you have told us often of the words once said by Grandpa Asel Smith.
Yes, that one of his descendants would come forth to promulgate a work that would revolutionize the world of religion.
I know that I am the one. I will tell the minister who has told me of his church and his doctrines. Well, I believe he will be pleased. Will not all men? Or will they doubt my simple story? Please, let me rest. I'll be all right.
Come, let's go.
Thank you.
Joseph! Joseph! Joseph, wake up! Joseph, Reverend Max is coming to the path. Do you suppose he has heard?
Not unless one of you has told him. I have told none else. He said he would drop by.
Want me to stay here with you while you tell him?
Oh, no. I think it would be best if we were left alone.
I'll be there.
I know. Almost my shadow, Hyrule. Bring him in, and trust that I may find the words to convert his heart, as he has striven so to convert mine.
Evening. Good evening, Hyrule. Come on in. God bless you, Hyrule.
Well, my son, I hope you've come to a happy conclusion. Your manner seems more sure.
My manner indicates my mind's great peace.
I trust that you have arrived at this through prayer.
Oh, that was the way. Well, I believe I knelt to pray as I have never done before. With faith, unquestioning, undoubting. My prayer was answered far beyond my hope. Well, I think I scarce can find the words to tell.
No need, boy, no need. For you're known about as a lad of great wisdom, for one not yet a man. Do you suppose your parents will come and follow and join our congregation? We can arrange baptism for you all immediately. Let me go and tell the others that you're soon to come.
Wait! It is not your faith I can accept. I have been shown a vision, told from heaven itself that your beliefs are wrong.
How so? If you leave me to believe one thing, then you fling this infamy upon me? Your parents, no doubt, have pulled you their way.
No, sir. The Methodists are quite as wrong as you. All of you lack the authority of Jesus Christ.
What, you presumptuous puppy? You teaching me principles of religion that I studied for years in seminary and taught? And if this authority is lost, just what do you propose to do about it? Did the heavens reveal that to you? Will you send into heaven, bring it back?
No. But an angel shall be sent to bring back the knowledge that has been lost for many years.
You upstart boy, you.
A boy? Yes, I am. But I am not totally unlearned in his word. I know it sounds presumptuous, and I know I am unworthy. But I have been told. These truths will be revealed to me. It is the truth. I swear to you the truth.
You're a victim of delusion. You're possessed! Out of my way!
He seemed enraged. Was he so indifferent then?
Indifferent and angry. Why, he almost seemed as that power that overcame me in the grove.
Perhaps then now we should not tell about it for a while.
More than ever now. Are you afraid, Hyrule? Afraid of men?
Joseph, you know I will stand by you. I'm afraid only for you.
Don't be. The heart has not room for both fear and faith. We must kneel often, Hyrule, and believe. Believe.
Mother must warm herself first.
She is so frail.
Then I will take her to Emma, who sorely needs whatever words of comfort she can give.
Poor mother has had the most difficult role. Yet she's proven herself again and again.
She has indeed been worthy. And I wish to God I could have spared her.
Spared you all. Don't let your mood be darkened by what has happened.
Now is the time that we must each gird ourselves, remembering the miracles. You yet will be triumphant, Joseph. Mothers of prophets have never had it easy, I suppose. Mother of Moses, giving up her son in all his tender years, in his manhood, and in his kingly pride. Think of the mother of our Savior who bore so much despair, knowing all the time that he was his tormentor's king, and could have called the wrath of heavens down upon his assailants.
But I am such a sinning man. In favor, perhaps, only so long as I am an obedient vessel. But what if I fail, Hiram? What if I succumb to the weakness of the flesh and do not prevail until the end?
You haven't even been listening to me. I am your elder brother. Hear me. You must not yield to this mood of bitterness and doubt. Self-searching does reveal us each to be a knave, unworthy of his mercy. But giving to this, and you've lost the battle to the one who could not down your flesh, nor stay your prayer before.
Mother, it grieves me to disturb you. You are so frail.
Frail? Well, my body, perhaps. But that is not the issue here. My spirit is not frail. One cannot help the things that befall the body. But he can tend the fires of the soul and keep them brightly burning. And when adversity comes, what then? The ever robust protest to the gods. They build their towers of strength they must defend, their brands and rage. The frail widow, then. But I have come to give comfort. Now, where is Emma? I lost. A daughter, my husband. I know the necessity for the tears of healing. I must tell her that she must rise again for the sake of those who are not lost. Don't. I have seen your eyes. I know their desperation. Remember, you have been chosen. You cannot fail. You will not fail. Hiram. Hiram will take care of your
soul. Ladies and gentlemen,
so intense, and suffering inflicted upon the members of the church was so bad. My brother Hiram and I fled, hoping our absence would cause those enemies to cease their harassment on the body of the saints.
Isn't it wonderful to feel free, Hiram? To be here in the cool woods? To feel safe?
Yes. Oh, yes.
I feel almost like my old happy self. What a laugh and a shout. You do like wrestling.
You do. Just a turn or two. I
My bones are beginning to creak like Cyhurst's wagon.
Give up?
Yes. I'm hungry. Shall we eat? Sounds like a good idea to me. So, Joseph, what about us leaving like this? Is it right for us to leave when our people are in such hard straits?
I know it's been bothering you. It's bothered me, too. But in the face of the current uprising of hatred and mobs, it seems the only way.
But remember when we left Missouri, and we came down with the cholera? You prophesied that when we returned, our enemies would not recognize us. They found us in our own beds and didn't know us. We passed them on the streets.
But things are different now. Those in authority are set against us.
But to leave our people at their mercy?
That is the reason, can't you see? The people are in danger because of me. It's not that I'm running away, but if the mobs know that I am gone, they will give up on the others. Later we can send for our families and friends. We can begin the work elsewhere.
The hatred since the printing press incident, since we escaped from Liberty Jail. If only that editor had listened when we warned him to cease his assaults on us.
But he would not. I was forced to go to him about his lies and attacks upon us. He was possessed of the very devil. So much of our property, even lives, have been destroyed because of their viciousness. Our people felt justified in destroying the presses.
All because of the vision. And the Book of Mormon. If only they understood it better, they would not fear or hate it so much. In the Bible, Jesus remarks that he had other sheep to visit.
It is merely another witness of his life, his divinity.
I know, Joseph. You still wish to go farther?
I fear it is the only way. If only Orin would get here with those horses, we could cross the river and be in our way before dark.
I think he's coming. But I hear only one horse.
Well, two of us can ride if we must. There's a place for us in the West where we would be more free to live and worship as we wish.
Hello. I hope the wait hasn't been too long.
It hasn't seemed too long. There's been much to discuss.
But the horses! Where are the horses?
I could not get them. And I could not have brought them in full daylight. Our enemies swarm about us like sticky flies. I'd have been followed out here as sure as sunlight. Everything is in turmoil.
Worse? I thought it would be better with me gone.
Much worse. The saints are bickering among themselves. They are frightened and think that you've deserted them.
Surely they can't think we've deserted them.
Yes, they do. They are saying it is like the fable, when the wolves came, the shepherd ran from the flock.
No. After all we've been through, can't they see the reason? It's only us they want.
They only see that if you don't give yourself up, they will be destroyed. Their property as well.
That's what Joseph was trying to avoid. He was hoping for their safety.
There's no safety for any of us now. We are bound together as a nut and a shell. I'd have been killed like a jackrabbit if they'd known my plans.
Even the most faithful ones doubt.
Yes. Even the most faithful ones doubt.
This is from Emma.
She begs me to return. She says there's great danger to them all.
In the cruelty of mob madness, I can understand it. If they can't have the blood they covet, then any blood will do. They've already tortured and killed many of our members.
Yes. And then think we have done this for glory, Hiram.
Instead, there's been fear and anguish all the way.
And this is from my friends. My friends! They accuse me of cowardice. What am I to do?
It is not for me to say, Joseph. But perhaps they feel if you do give yourself up for trial, it will satisfy the mob.
They have no charge against the other members.
Only that of the printing press that can be drawn against us all. Especially since the lies made it seem so much worse than it was. And there were none there to tell our side.
No. And their devilish lies know no limit. It would surprise me if every yellow dog in Illinois hadn't turned against us.
In time, there may not be a yellow dog left to tell the tale. Brother Orrin is right, though. Governor Ford has definitely given in to their stories.
There is no mercy there. No mercy at all. Yet it is as I have said. As sure as we fall into their hands, we are dead men. I wrote to Stephen Martin that if ever we were taken again, we would be massacred.
But we've been miraculously saved so many times.
The hour is not yet come. Would to God that it could be postponed. There's so much to do, so much I would tell my flock. But my life is of no value to my friends. Then it is of none to myself.
As you make your bed, I will be with you.
Joseph. I will not leave you or desert you. It would be better if you did.
You at least could leave. Save your own lives. With men such as you two and Brigham Young, the work could be carried on.
Where you go, I will go.
We will go back. Give ourselves up and see this thing out.
We shall be butchered. My life is of no consequence. Though I do not want to die, I will if need be. I have always known in my inmost heart that my life, my testimony, will be sealed with my blood. It is my destiny. I cannot flee from it.
In the face of things, it seems the only thing to do. We will all stand by you.
I will send word to Governor Ford tomorrow that I will go to Carthage. Since you will make no effort to come to me, though I fear it shall mean that I shall never see Nauvoo again.
We will go together.
Iron, you are braver than I. You have taken good care of my soul. I am going like a lamb to the slaughter, but I am as calm as a summer's morning. I have a conscience void of offense toward God and toward all men. If they take my life, I shall die an innocent man. And my blood shall cry out for vengeance from the ground. And it shall be said of me, he was murdered in cold blood.
But Joseph, you may yet be saved. The work must be carried on.
And it shall. But why do you not think to save yourself? You have not had to follow this course. You did not see the vision. It is not your blood they cry for.
My testimony is burned on my soul. As surely as if I had seen it with my own eyes. The Holy Ghost has borne witness to me of it. Is that not its mission?
Yes. And to comfort the soul. Even now I am reminded that life is eternal. Death is not the end.
I have seen greatness here today. You brethren ride the horse. I feel strength to walk. Strength to fight dragons if need be.
Thank you. There is so much good here for us all. So much peace. I am reluctant to leave.
There is no other choice.
I know. And in a sense, I am relieved in knowing. One's life is a small price to pay for eternal life and eternal truth. Shall we kneel here together?
Born of the same blood, we kneel here together. Brothers in more than blood and flesh that shall decay. Bound by a love so deep that earth and hell and heaven itself shall pass before that love shall pass away.
John.
Hiram. Once you said you would give your life for me. Now I'm afraid you may be asked to do so.
My heart is indeed willing. And may God help me that my flesh not falter if that time should come.
Total dread escape among us. Hiram and myself were taken captive to jail in the company of five others of our brethren. Willard Richards, John Taylor, Dan Jones, John F. Fuller, and Stephen Markham. We wait. Below, the mob circles us and the lions stop taking prey.
Should do. What do you think the governor's reply was?
His usual evasions and hypocrisy.
This time it was more than evasion. It was blasphemous. He said, and my council reported this verbatim, you have Carthage grazed at your command. Immediately, Captain Robert F. Smith summoned his grays to execute illegally against us, and we were committed
to this shameful place.
I, too, protested to the governor, as you know, but craven as he is and probably afraid for his own life if the mob spirit increased, he said that there was nothing he could do and the law must take its course.
The law? The lynch law? The law of the savage, shedding blood, not justice.
And I've heard it said in the square that if the law can't reach us, then powder and ball must. We've done nothing to harm them.
Story shall yet be told. I believe the honest in heart will know of our sincerity, Joseph. Would I could spare you the pain, the humiliation.
It is the Lord's will. I do not regret it. But I would like to see my family once again. And I would to God that I could preach to the saints in Nauvoo. I have so much to tell them.
Do not be discouraged. You have been miraculously spared before.
This time we will not be so fortunate. Now my heart yearns toward my people. If this death will surely spare them, then it is of small consequence. Hiram, you should detach yourself from me, so that I could be sure the work could be carried on.
My life is attached to yours. I feel deeply, however, that my family will raise up a rich progeny to this work and to see to its fulfillment.
And my family, Hiram?
I don't know. You know them better than I.
Yes. I know that Emma's family has influenced her. She cannot accept all the covenants. But her love and loyalty to me has kept her true.
I do not believe she doubts the truth of the visions.
Joseph, don't think of the unpleasant things at this time.
We must still be of good courage.
I have never doubted the courage of any of you here. Only my own. But I am calm. Sad, but calm. And as for pleasantness, the thought of Emma in her beauty and pride are of the utmost pleasure to me. If need be, I would go to the depths of hell for her.
It's getting pretty late. We should get some rest. We'll need all our wits about us tomorrow.
Yes, tomorrow. And tomorrow, and tomorrow. But what of you others? I must not take the bet from you.
You must. You and Patriarch Hiram. We will do well here on the floor.
No.
As a physician, I order you to do so, Joseph. Your great strength is about exhausted. You've endured more than any man should ever be called a bear.
Perhaps so. I feel an old man. And I am only 39. Perhaps that is why they call me Old Joe.
That's just a filthy mouth. They'd likely call me the same when I'm still young.
Hardly more than a boy, but most loyal.
I intend to remain loyal. Always.
Hiram, come lie beside me once more. Remember the nights we spent at each other's side as boys, counting the stars in the heavens, and sharing our hopes and our dreams? You said to speak of pleasant things, and there are many. Naboo.
And the mansion house.
Though I fear I shall not see it again in this life.
The darkness is coming down. Perhaps we'd all best retire?
I am weary. Weary of thinking, of wondering, and hoping. I would not turn back, though. I would not change my course. My testimony of this gospel is as complete as the record of my birth. Whether I live or die, it must stand through all the ages to come.
With God's help, the work will go on. I seem to see in the distance a place where our people will find their peace, where their fields will flourish, and their young people will be unafraid to say, I am a Latter-day Saint. A Mormon, if you please. I see the missionaries going to houses in all the world, telling the story, and bringing those who seek after righteousness into the fold. I have been an instrument in bringing this about. If my usefulness is finished.
An instrument, indeed. You have been the head. The beginning.
But not indispensable. Others will carry on. Will be called great in the pages of history. From Adam downward, each prophet, each leader has done his part, and then gone on to make room for another.
And in most cases, the crowd is turned against them. The mobs have cried for their blood, too. Look how the pleasures and desires of the flesh diverted the followers of Moses. Though they knew of his nearness to God.
And he did not live to enter the promised land. Even as I shall die before my people shall find the Zion which is promised to all those who are faithful.
Your voice, your words are like liniment to my sore soul. But I must encourage you to get some rest.
Brother Jones, you will fulfill a mission. You have been called to Wales.
But that all seems a distant past now. I'm here with you, that is enough.
so much to write, so much to tell. The history must be complete so that future generations shall know the truth and shall judge us honestly according to our hearts and our work.
And you, Brother Richards, have the gift to write it, my good friend. I tell you, your progeny shall be a proud one.
Sound like a shot, Joseph.
Excellent helps. Faith dispels fear.
Let me lie between you here. I will speak with you. Brother Fulmer, you have been a most loyal friend. I wish I had not brought you to this.
Do not apologize to me, Brother Joseph. Many wish for the chance to die for what they believe. Few have that opportunity.
How proudly put. Are you afraid to die?
Has that time come to you?
I'm afraid so.
Engaged in such a cause, I do not think a death would hold too many terrors.
You will yet live to see Wales and perform the mission that has been appointed unto you.
Then perhaps we shall all be spared.
Dan, since you are here of your own free will, would you go down and question them as to the shot we heard in the night?
Yes, sir.
Come on, get yourself washed.
John and Stephen,
now would be a good time for you two to go to the Saints at Nauvoo. Return if you wish.
We will return.
Sir, why was our shot fired in the night?
We had too much trouble bringing old Joe here to ever let him escape alive. Unless you want to die with him, you'd better leave. You're not a bit better than he is.
I wish I were a thousand parts as good.
Well, neither him nor his brother or anyone with him will live to see the sunset today.
We'll see about that. I'm going to see the governor.
Say?
I assure you, Your Honor, there was a shot fired in the night. When I questioned the guardians, the prophet and his friends would be dead before sunset.
You are unnecessarily alarmed, boy. People are not that cruel.
But I heard them. I saw the hate in their eyes. Why don't you put more able men to guard them? The Smiths are American citizens. They surrender themselves to you because you pledged their safety and your honor. I demand their protection.
They will be duly cared for.
I overheard the officer say that their troops would be discharged. But when you and McDonald troops, who are the most friendly to my people, have left for Nauvoo, they will come back and kill these men if they have to tear the jail down.
The Almighty will preserve my life until such a time that I can testify that you were duly warned of their danger.
We are doing the best we can. Excuse me.
I will return and tell them. God pity you, Governor. They are cowardice in sacrificing these innocent men.
Mormons! Scum!
And though I would be called to lay down my life, to forsake my wife and children, yet I know this word is true. And I will give all. For I know God lives, and all will be restored to me.
I see Dan Jones at the gate. They're refusing him admittance. I assume by that they will not let Brother Fulmer or Markham return to us either.
It is only my life and blood which they want. You are free to walk out.
I'm not Joseph, legally nor morally.
In a latter sense, neither are we. But we're strong. The need comes to fight. We shall defend ourselves. You have a gun, don't you?
I have a six-barrel pistol which one of the saints gave to me. But it's against everything in my nature to think of using it.
Brother Fulmer has left a pistol here. Please God that we won't be forced to fire them.
Survival is the first law of life. Though I myself detest all forms of violence, yet in my profession I see so often what the will to live can and does do.
Against the mob?
Not outnumbered too badly, perhaps even there.
We have read and written and told of our testimonies. Let's rest. It's nearing 3 o'clock.
Yes. I did have a restless night. Brother Taylor, it would do my heart good to hear you sing once more.
Let us all sing together.
No, not today. The gospel hymns would be soiled by this very air. Sing that old favorite of mine, A Poor Wayfaring Man of Grief.
Are you so sad of spirit?
Yes. It's not easy to die. Though when the time comes, I'm sure it will be one of triumph. It's just the memories. The scent of flowers. The woman you have loved. Your children? I tell you, men, we would be less than human if we did not wish to retain these things.
But we will retain these things in an even more perfect state in the life to come. This is not an idle hope. Each of us knows it to be true. Before God and all men, there is life after death.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, Brother Taylor, sing to us, please. Sing to me.
A poor wayfaring man of grief hath often crossed me on my way. Who sued so humbly for relief that I could never answer nay. I had not power to ask his name, whereto he went or whence he came. Yet there was something in his eye that won my love, I knew not why. Then in a moment to my view, the Savior stranger started from disguise. The tokens in his hands I knew, the Savior stood before mine eyes. He spake and my poor shall thy memorial be. Fear not, thou didst them unto me.
Please, sing it again. Your voice makes it almost a lullaby.
A poor wayfaring man.
Hold! You can't come in here! Wait! Hold!
Our children! Shut up the hill! Get the fucking stick! Let's guard the door!
We'll kill the first man who enters! Let me straight!
Cautious as you drive down home because you are in a city